Circle of Life Coalition on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.
Good evening and thank you for joining us. My name is Judy Wechter. I am a member of the Circle of Life Coalition and host of Circle of Life programming here on BCTV. The Coalition's mission is educating the community and professionals in all aspects of end-of-life care. Each month, we discuss a topic designed to provide you and your family with the necessary information to make the best decisions, and our show tonight does just that. I have always wanted to say something about our show going to the dogs, and I was really never able to fulfill that. And Colleen, tonight I can say our show is going to the dogs.
Yes, it is.
We have Emmett with us tonight.
Hi, bud.
Emmett is a therapy dog.
Yes, he is.
Colleen, you are the Director of Rehabilitative Services with Genesis at the Mifflin Court and Center, which is skilled nursing and assisted living. Mm-hmm. You are going to be doing the educational series on February 7th at 7:45 a.m. at the McGlynn Conference Center on the campus of the University of Alvernia. Mm-hmm. And you are going to be talking about the healing power of pets.
Yes.
And what a joy and thrill for me to know that we have one of the stars here with us tonight. Emmett. Hi,
yes.
Bud. Emmett is an English sheepdog, correct?
Yep.
And he is 11?
11, yes.
11.
Yep. He's been working since he was 5 months old. So he has put in a lot of time and hours.
So Colleen, let me just start with that. How does a dog get involved, or someone makes the decision for the dog that you are going to be a therapy pet?
He had gotten neutered, and I was concerned about how he was going to do at home. Mm-hmm. So he went to work with me, when he was 5 months old, and I was working in a long-term care setting. And he came through the back door of the facility, and there was a gentleman sitting there who, had Parkinson's disease, and a lot of times with Parkinson's disease, they have the flat mm-hmm. affect.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I had never seen this man smile in a year and a half. And Emmett was much smaller then, and he went over to him, and he put his paws up on the gentleman's wheelchair, and a smile just lit up this man's face. And I said, okay, I guess you're going to be a therapy dog.
Wow.
He just, you know, he was a puppy, and so taking him into that setting, I thought he's going to be rambunctious at home. He's chasing balls and playing with the other dog, and I thought, well, we're going to try this and see how it goes. And he just calmed down in that setting. He really just took to it like it was what he was meant to do. Yeah.
So how long is the training? What is the training like for a dog who is identified as being a good candidate for a pet therapy?
He did a lot of on-the-job training. So a lot of it is basic obedience type things, you know, sitting, stay, lay, meeting a friendly stranger, meeting a friendly dog. And then also becoming okay with the various things that happen in that type of setting. So oxygen tubing, oxygen tanks, assistive devices, various noises and sounds that mm-hmm. people can make that aren't, you know, something that a normal dog would hear. So he came to work with me. There was a lot of stay and trying to teach him, you know, when someone is walking around him,
right.
don't get up and move.
Right.
But like I said, he took to it like he was meant for it.
What a face. He primarily has been working with seniors, correct?
Yes, seniors, and initially it started with children too. Approximately once a year, he does do a child's camp that my horse also does. And they always love seeing him come because he's one of their highlights.
And as the director of therapy, you are well steeped in your center, both centers. You are just well steeped in all of the techniques and all of the goals for seniors depending on varying levels mm-hmm. of cognition, physicality, strength. Talk a little bit about how the pet therapy can affect positively any of those aspects, whether it's mental, physical.
It's both ways, you know, mentally and physically. He helps not only the patients, their families. A lot of families come in and develop a relationship with him too. And I find that a lot of times when patients who were very close to him are near end of life and their families are there and they've heard so much about Emmett, and his presence kind of helps soothe the resident, soothe the family. The staff, it's the same with the staff. If Emmett's not at work, everybody is kind of wondering where he is he okay? And he elevates the mood in the facility that he's mm-hmm. in. Mm-hmm. The residents become used to his schedule. In his older years, I've tried to semi-retire him. He loves to work. That is his being. He loves to work. And so I try to give him one day off a week. And whenever he's not at work, every resident I pass, where's Emmett? Where's your shadow? You know, what's going on? And I say, it's his day off. Oh, yeah, it is Wednesday.
So, and as the director, you're very busy.
Yes.
You are very
yes.
busy.
So, you know, the poor dog, I said, with the amount of treats and the food that he gets at home, he should weigh probably 300 pounds. But he's constantly moving. He's all over the facility. He'll find the residents that have the treats, and then he'll go and he'll just stop in their rooms periodically throughout the day. So besides that, we do have residents that come in, and I mean, a lot of people own animals, and what goes along with that is the care of the animal. So feeding them, watering them, taking them out to go to the bathroom, cleaning up after them after they do go to the bathroom.
Do you allow your residents in assisted living to have dogs?
I believe they're allowed to have cats in our facility. So we kind of gear things. If that's what they were doing before they went to the hospital or before whatever incident brought them to us, then that becomes one of their goals.
I see.
You know, walking the dog. And he's one of his testing qualifications was that he had to walk well on a leash. So not like my other dog who'll pull your arm off, but nice and calm and not tripping people with the leash and staying where he needs to be. So they'll do that. They'll get him food. They'll get him water.
Will the residents actually, will part of the therapy be with a therapist walking down the hallway with him as a dog?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Or outside. You know, part of our therapy is in our facility, it's the most controlled environment. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like a home where you might have things on the floor. You know, you come home, kick your shoes off, and so there's not clutter there. It's
right.
very controlled, and it's the most, the easiest environment that they're going to be in. So we do take them out outside of the facility, walk them on different surfaces, that kind of thing. And he goes with, you know. We've had people walk him down our sidewalk and back up our sidewalk. We have a circle in our garden area that has different types of surfaces on it. So he goes outside on a leash, walks around his circle with the patient. So we get an idea of how they are going to fare outside mm-hmm. of those mm-hmm. very contained and controlled environments.
So that aspect of the therapy is geared towards individuals who are the disposition or their plan is to return mm-hmm. home. So counter that with his therapy and his use for the individuals who are not going home. In your skilled nursing facility, the skilled nursing part, where residents are not going to be going home. Talk about really what his effect is and what his job is there.
So a lot of patients, when they get towards the more advanced stages of dementia, trying to give them a very structured treatment session can be difficult. The attention to task isn't there all the time. And if you ask someone, hey, let's do some balance, you know, it's not quite as much fun as if you say, do you want to play fetch with the dog? So, you know, he loves to play fetch. That is his favorite thing in the world. You would think it would be hurting, but it's not. You know, you start on a normal surface and the patient plays fetch with Emmett. Well, then you change their surface and make it a little bit more challenging for them. And it's more fun for them to do that as opposed to doing balance activities that we may ask them to do. We have one patient that she was very hard to get her to attend to anything. And I happened to be on vacation, and which means he was on vacation. Mm-hmm. And when I came back the first day, one of my therapists had her in the gym. And she immediately turned and took a beeline for him. And my therapist said, okay. And she said, this is the first time she's ever engaged in something for longer than 5 seconds. And she sat there and she pet him and... So then we used him as part of her therapy. Very low level people, just mm-hmm. petting him. We'll do that to try to get them to just move their arms, move their hands. And it gives them a calming reaction. It lowers their blood pressure, you know, decreases their heart rate, and just makes them more comfortable. I have a feeling that when I'm at that stage, that will do wonders for me. And not everybody likes him. Mm-hmm. Not everybody's a dog person.
Correct.
At Mifflin Center, we do have other animals too. There's a cat that's there. We have birds. So, you know, there's different animals to help them relax. Yes. Really get the most out of their life.
Can you legitimately, realistically use him during their therapy hours and minutes?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, we do. Like I said, he becomes part of, whether it's the higher level people that's what they need to be able to do to go home. You know, say you have someone who doesn't have a lot of family around or lives with a spouse who might be a little bit more debilitated than they are, but they don't want to give up their dog. He is their way of finding out how much they can do. What do we need to work on to be able to get them to where they need to be? Mm-hmm. And we do use him as much as we can. And the lower level people, again, it's just we do comfort and low level groups where it's just getting them to attend to a task. And what better task than petting the dog, you know, or brushing him. You know, you get the extremity movement, you've got to hold the brush. It might not seem like a lot, but for someone who wasn't doing that before,
absolutely,
that's something that
absolutely
is a step in the right direction for them.
And so. And really, I used to work for Manor Care. Mm-hmm. And it's not just clinical. It's about improving their life. Yeah, mm-hmm. quality of life.
Yeah.
So when you're referring to a Parkinson's patient, and that the disease process and the affect, you know, you can't change that.
Mm-mm.
But wow, for someone who experiences that, and for me, I have to believe somewhere deep in their brain, they are realizing this disease process and how they are. And it has to be depressing. It has mm-hmm. to be very difficult knowing and understanding that you have changed, you are going to continue to change because of your disease process. And it's going to get worse.
Yeah.
So to have an animal be able to generate something contrary to the disease process is amazing
mm-hmm.
and improves the quality of life. Just think, if after that he receives visitors and he or she is really upbeat and excited and happy because mm-hmm. of the encounter with an animal. In this mm-hmm. case, we're talking about Emmett, but you're referring to other animals, cats, birds, and, mm-hmm. and the like. That visit could be a far better visit because he had the encounter with the mm-hmm. animal first.
Yep.
So it's about improving the quality of life.
Yeah, and two, in our you've talked about our long-term care residents. That is their home.
Yeah.
That's their home now.
Yep.
And so many people have animals in their homes, or they used to have animals in their homes. And he comes in their room and he lays down and he, you know, it's like having a dog in your home, you know? And I always tell him, I'm like, hey, you guys feed him just as much as I have to, because with the biscuits and they're very cute and they're so loving and,
yeah.
You know, they get worried about him just as much as I do. And it's very lovely. I think he has it pretty well.
You know, I never understood why some individuals, long-term care residents, would not be very nice towards their caregivers.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't understand that, because on the very basic level of care, the CNAs who are with these individuals long periods of time, takes care of them very, very compassionately, very lovingly, and sometimes they're just not, they just can't reciprocate.
Mm-hmm.
And I one time said, as I was just starting out in skilled nursing, I said, I do not get this. And somebody explained to me that they lost a lot of control in their life. And so they're really angry about the loss of control.
Mm-hmm.
And the only person or the target is the individual who is coming to take care of them. And I think, wow, that is difficult to spend the next 10 years mm-hmm. being in that state. So the ability for this dog to be able to reveal to them that there is more than the frustration and the hatred of losing mm-hmm. all the control and where they are, that this animal can do that for them is the real power, is the real mm-hmm. healing piece. It's not healing a cut. It's not healing a broken bone. It's not making you walk when you've been bedridden for 5 years. It's not about that. It is just this eruption inside them, because I've seen it, that just elevates them. And if only for a short period of time they forget about the loss,
mm-hmm.
that's an incredible power.
Yeah. We, and to, like I said, with the dementia, sometimes you have residents who have behaviors
right.
that can be outwardly aggressive towards people who are, like you said, trying to help them. And in particular, there was one resident who loved him and called him Mookie. He's had so many different names.
I can imagine because they don't remember.
No. It's usually the name of one of their dogs.
Oh, true.
The gentleman called him Mookie. And this gentleman in particular could be very aggressive. And it turned out that Emmett was his intervention. You know, in the long-term care setting, we try to do whatever we can to negate having to give a medicine to stop the behavior. So Emmett became his medicine. If he was the one time he was swinging and nobody could get near him, and they were trying to put some rub medication on him, and they called me and said, "Will you please bring him down?" And I said, "Sure." So I brought him down, and all we had to do was get Emmett in his line of vision. And when we did that, the behavior stopped immediately. And he said, "Oh, Mookie," and pet him, completely forgot about whatever had caused him to become agitated. And it was like nothing ever happened. And Emmett very rarely is without me. But I was doing my paperwork and I couldn't find him. And I look out and there he is laying next to the gentleman out in a central area. And the gentleman is looking at the paper and then he looks over at Emmett and he says, "Oh, Mookie, yeah." And then we would pet him and then he'd look back and then he'd Mookie and then pet him again. You know, it was just the relationships that people develop with him that I can't, you know, I can't explain or.
One of the questions I was going to ask you is, does pet therapy affect sundowning?
Yes. Yeah.
So the example that you just gave for individuals who work with seniors that are on the dementia spectrum understand sundowning. And I thought, ooh, that seems like that could be maybe too far of a reach for a pet and pet therapy. But you just described that it even can, wow.
So we adjusted my work schedule too, so that I was there about the time that he would generally start getting agitated. And then we would use Emmett as the intervention, which would then make the rest of the night better for him. Because sometimes the initial onset of the sundowning would then carry over and it could be a very long night for him.
Man, there is nothing worse than that period of time at the nurse's station where you have residents in a skilled nursing facility, residents who are agitated at particular hours, who are experiencing sundowning, and they're at the nurse's station because they need to keep their eye on them, particularly their behaviors in general, medications that may have given them. And then that interferes, I'm not saying it's terrible, but I mean, interferes with them completing the rest of their duties for the other residents in the facility. Yep. So the ability for a therapy dog or a therapy animal to really be a member of the nursing team is very important. That means the more time is given to someone else it is needed. So that is very cool. Has Emmett ever won any awards?
No, he hasn't.
He should. Yes.
He should. I have not logged his visits. Generally, you log their visits because the therapy dogs that I know of don't go in every day. And they're supposed to get an award at 50 visits. And I said, well, he got that the first year he was working, you know. I don't know how many visits he has now. Like I said, he'll be 12 the day of the talk, or the day after the talk, the presentation. And he's been working pretty much consistently since he was 5 months old. So
does he have a 401k plan?
he definitely gets his vacation and sick time when he needs it. Yes. Personal days. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's built up a lot of that time. Is there clinical evidence to support this?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like I said, physiologically, when you're petting an animal, it has that calming effect. It lowers the blood pressure, decreases heart rate, slows your breathing. Not to an extreme level, but, it just gives you the calm.
Right.
And again, it might not always be a dog. The cat that we have in the facility, he has his people that he goes to and he interacts with them, and it's the same type of thing. The fish, we have fish, and some people go and sit in the dining room and just watch the fish swim.
Right.
And it really does calm people down. And the residents in the facility, like I said before, they develop a relationship with the animals. Mm-hmm. At Mifflin Court, we have a bird cage in the center area.
Yes.
And the people that sit and watch those birds, if one is being picked on, they let us know that animal is being picked
right.
on, and then we can call somebody and see if maybe we need to take that bird out so that they don't get hurt.
Right.
And they just, they sit and they watch the interactions, and it does. It adds to
yeah.
their life. It
yeah.
gives them a better quality of life because they become attached to that.
Right.
And that becomes an exciting part of your day.
Right. Exactly. Well, I really want to thank you. And thank you, Emmett. Thank you, Emmett, for coming. I really appreciate that. Colleen Kononov.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I got it right.
Mm-hmm.
Colleen Kononov is the Director of Rehabilitation with Genesis. She is at the Mifflin Court and Center. I want to thank Emmett for being with us tonight. Is Emmett going to be with you on February 7th?
Of course. Yes.
Please join Colleen February 7th at the McGlynn Conference Center on the campus of Alverni University for her presentation on the healing power of pets. Thank you all for joining us. And don't forget, if you want more information, go to the website www.circleoflifecoalition.org. We'll see you next time.
Circle of Life Coalition on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging.